This is The Speaking Show. I'm David Newman, and you're tuned in to the number one podcast for speakers, consultants, and experts who want to speak more profitably. Well, you are in for a real treat today. I am here with Charlene Lee, who's the author of 6 books, including the New York Times bestseller, Open Leadership, and co-author of the critically acclaimed book, Groundswell. Her latest book is the bestseller, The Disruption Mindset. She is the founder and senior fellow at Altimeter, an analyst firm that was acquired in 2015 by Profit. And we'll talk about all of that good stuff. I'm sure there's a big adventure there. Charlene is a graduate of Harvard College and Harvard Business School and was named one of the most creative people in business by Fast Company. Welcome to The Speaking Show.
Thank you so much for having me.
I was going to say before reading your official introduction that when you look up thought leader in the dictionary, there's Charlene's picture just waving, going, "Hi, you're talking about me. That's me." So let's talk about your evolution into this kind of thought leadership with the 6 books, with all of this amazing work that you've done over the past years. What were some of the interesting stops along the way? And just paint the picture of your professional evolution as the thinker and speaker that you are today.
I came out of Harvard Business School and went into a very non-traditional role. I went to newspapers. And the reason was because it was 1993. I wanted to be at the beginning of what the same was called the internet. We had no World Wide Web then. So I ended up at the San Jose Mercury News in Silicon Valley, had a front row seat to all the changes that were happening. And because I was leading a lot of disruptive groups in San Jose and then later on in Boston with a community newspaper company, I got a lot of opportunities to do press, to be out there speaking about the disruptive things that we were doing. In 1997, we debuted basically community publishing. Now, this is way back, okay, way before there was anything like blogs. And so we were doing some really disruptive things then. And I went from there into Forrester, being an analyst. And by definition, what you do is write thought leadership, writing these reports. And then kept going and writing books and then starting my company and always had an opportunity throughout this entire period to be, I had never thought of myself as a thought leader. I just thought I was helping people understand all these disruptive trends. So that's been my passion, is helping people thrive with disruption. And that's been my career.
And then the Groundswell book, that really blew up. Was that really the first big major splash into kind of the mainstream business universe? You know, when you and Josh wrote that book, did that take off bigger than you thought, or how did that go?
Oh, much bigger. I mean, we thought we had a really good book on our hands. Basically, I had a book inside of me that needed to come out because the story just wasn't being told in 20-page reports. It needed a book to describe this new phenomenon called social media. And so to our pleasant surprise and to our glee, frankly, well, people really liked the book. We were kind of shocked. And to this day, people will come up to me and say, that book changed your lives. They changed your careers. They started companies based on this. And it's just humbling to think that your words just gave people this perspective. So that's been a thrill.
Let's talk about some of these different definitions, because people that do not yet know your work, number one, they're missing out. But number two, I think it's also very important to establish the vocabulary. And so going back to 2008, what were some of these patterns that were emerging that you were able to crystallize and that we now all, I think, commonly call a groundswell or a groundswell type of platform or movement?
Well, in 2008, people were not used to this idea that people had power and that they could use their voices in such a different way. And so it was a completely different world. Imagine a time where you were really limited in terms of what your voice could have. And then people were discovering that their voice had power. And if they could get people to follow them on social media, they could be leaders just by simply having followers. So this was incredibly challenging to businesses that thought they had the upper hand. Wait, what do you mean? Consumers can actually have more power than my brand machine could have? This was completely different foreign thinking. And we take it for granted today. But 10 years ago, this was revolutionary.
And so then we actually started to talk more and more about leadership, right? Because then two other books came that were around the concept of leadership. I guess both organizational leadership and this type of groundswell leadership. Talk about how that pivot happened and then where that took us.
It was very organic. So after I wrote Groundswell, these leaders kept coming up to me. And I remember one conversation in particular with a CEO, and he said, "I get it. I have to be more open. We need to be more transparent and authentic. Just tell me, how open do I need to be?" And I thought, wait a minute, that's actually a really good question. Because you can't be 100% open. So how do you determine what you can do and other? What's the equation? What's the formula? And so when I don't know the answer to something, I go do research and then I do writing and a book comes out of it. So that's what happened with open leadership. And that just resonated at a time where, again, people were just beginning to explore this and didn't know what it meant to have an open leader, be an open organization. So again, I got very lucky in terms of the timing. But then that came out to the Engaged Leader in 2015 that talked about how do you change your personal leadership? How do you have to show up differently as a leader in the digital era? And I tell you, leaders are still very much struggling with that. They have not even begun to understand how they have to be thinking about this in a very different way.
I'm guessing there's probably multiple layers to that when you say in the digital era. One is that everybody has a voice, right? And everyone is in the social media soup. But also a lot of these global companies, there's now virtual leadership where your leadership might, it's not down the hall, it's not in the conference room anymore. Now it's on Zoom, now it's on video, now it's on video and conference calls and all sorts of other kind of virtual leadership where you don't get to be in the same room with a lot of the people that you're leading. Do those two concepts intersect, or are those two just separate sides of the same coin?
Oh, no, same thing. And I even talked to another CEO. He goes, "I don't believe in any of this. My leadership is personal. I go up to somebody and I shake their hand, wish them a happy birthday, tell them to do a great job. That's how I lead." And I go, "You have 10,000 employees. You can't shake the hand of every single one of those employees. But with digital, you can digitally, virtually shake their hand, look in their eye every day and say, 'We're good, right? We're good.'" And you can listen at scale. And so I look at it this way. Leadership is simply a relationship between people who lead and people who follow. And relationships are formed by communications. Communications have become digital. We all know this at a personal level. We maintain our relationships through all of these digital channels. So why does it stop at the leadership door? Why does it stop at your company? We should take all of that skills, all of that learning, and become comfortable being a leader in these digital spaces. And the pushback I get from leaders is, "Who cares what I had for lunch?" And I agree with them. I don't care what you had for lunch. What I care about is, what did you talk about over lunch? That's the difference. And people want to hear from you. They want you to show up as their leader and lead them. So give them that opportunity. This is a gift to them. And the other pushback I get is, "Well, it's not about me. I'm the leader. I'm a servant leader. I lead with other people." I'm like, "That's great, but you need to show up. This is not about you. This is about them. And when you show up, it's all about them. So show up as much as you can for them."
Yeah, wow. Well, and also I think in a traditional leadership conversation, people sometimes say, "Well, you know, your team is looking at you. Your staff, your entire company is looking at you and they're interpreting, you know, when you're frowning and you're delivering some news that could catch fire and that could go all over the place." Now in the digital world, are they looking at those leaders 10 times more closely and picking up little nuances of what they say in the digital world? And how is that kind of amplified and magnified, that personal brand or that personal leadership that basically by breathing, they're communicating their leadership on some level?
And the more you show up, the more they learn how to anticipate and interpret those signals, right? And here's the other thing. It goes both ways. You can tell if they're curious about something, like, "Why is he frowning?" He goes, "I was just frowning because I was thinking." You can counter that. We treat the digital space as if it was so analog, as if communications was so really precious and scarce, and so it has to be perfect. In the digital space, you can show up as you are. I'm far from perfect, right? And the more people see you as imperfect, the deeper the relationship goes, because it allows you to not be perfect, to say, "I don't know what the future is, but we're going to tackle it together. Are you with me? That is incredibly powerful because a leader then says, I can't do this alone. I have to do it with you. Are you with me?
Yeah, that's a very important distinction. It's about leadership is something that we do with you. We don't do it to you.
Yes. And this goes back again to some great research that Robert Keller did back in the 80s around followership. And it's about the relationship that you have with your followers. How will you define that? And I think in a digital space, you have an opportunity to define that relationship every single day. You're asking other people to put on the mantle of leadership themselves and show up as leaders themselves. I like to say leadership is not a title. It is a state of mind. And you're a leader if you're trying to create change. So you don't have to have a title to be a leader.
Hey, good looking. Are you currently getting paid to speak? Would you like to ramp that up? We can help. Book a confidential speaker strategy call with our team at doitmarketing.com/call, and let's see what we might do together. The call is free, but the results may be priceless. Well, springboarding right into that about the change, your new platform, your new groundswell, your new area of study and innovation is around disruption. And, you know, that term has been around, I think, in popular usage, probably the last 5-10 years, very squishy term. I think half the people that use it have no idea what it means. You've really dialed this in. And this is where you're writing books. You're doing a lot of great work around this. You're building communities around this. What's your definition of disruption? And then let's talk about the disruption mindset, the book, the movement, the whole philosophy.
Yeah. Disruption happens when the power relationships are changing and shifting. And so something's happening to change the status quo. It's disrupting the apple cart, the way that you see the world. And it's neutral. It could be positive or it could be negative. And what I think about having a disruption mindset says, I'm going to look at disruption as an opportunity. I'm going to pursue it. I may even create it because it will drive exponential growth. And that's the key. I have so many friends in Silicon Valley who go around and say, disrupt or die. They wave their hands and they raise a ruckus. And everyone goes, yes, we have to disrupt. What do we do? And that person goes, that's up to you. They walk off the stage. And I just went, you know, I'm tired of this. Where are the positive examples? Where are the places that we can look to say, here's how you do disruption correctly? Because we have Blockbuster, we have Toys R Us, we have Kodak, we have all these bad examples of what disruption can do. Where are the positive ones? And so again, when I have a question I don't know the answer to, I go do some research. And after a year, this book came out. And it's been, I think more than anything else, giving people the confidence that they can actually thrive with disruption, that they can actually go through a transformation and succeed and not fail.
One of the things that you talk about in the book is, quote unquote, the simple secret of disruption. I even love what you said a moment ago about how do you do disruption right? And people are like, no, I thought it was random. I thought we're just like, oh, let's just blow things up and see where it goes. But it's much more intentional. It's much more strategic. What is the secret? And then what are some guidelines that you have in the book about quote unquote doing it right?
Right. I looked at all these disruptive organizations, one who pivot, who go through a transformation and drive exponential growth. And they do one thing, which is they focus on their future customer. And that means they serve their current customer extremely well, but they also know that that current customer probably isn't the future customer. So they spend a lot of time intentionally understanding who that future customer is, investing resources today and the people today. They may even make sacrifices today to go after that future. And this is the problem. When I talk to a lot of companies, they have a good idea what that future looks like, but they're unable and unwilling to make that commitment today because they worry about quarterly losses or investments, or it's not 100% sure. So should we go after it? Because we have to be absolutely sure. We have to be perfect. And people with disruption mindsets throw all of that out the window. Like, okay, we may have to make sacrifices, but all of our stakeholders understand why. We're aligned up and down and throughout our entire ecosystem, why we're going after this future customer, why we're making this investment today. And they execute, even though they don't know exactly where it is, but it's better to head off in that direction than to stay still. That's the secret. It's so simple, but incredibly difficult. When I go into companies and when I'm doing advisory for them, I ask them, show me your strategic plan. So if they can find it, they go show it to me. And it's oftentimes a 12-month budget. That's not a strategic plan. That just says, I will get through the next X number of months. And it's at the end of that year, you only have 3 more months. He can't make investments into the future. So really well-run companies, and to your point, disruptive organizations aren't in total chaos. In fact, this is the most interesting thing I learned. They're incredibly well-run. They're very organized. And it's when they have everything organized, where everybody knows where everything works, that they were able to go as fast as possible into that future.
Let's role play this for a quick second. I'm going to play one of your Fortune 100 CEOs, and we can do a little word association exercise, or I'll just give you the 4 words that are popping into my head, and you please reassure me that I'm not going to throw away my career. Because what you just said is so brilliant, but I'm sure the objections you get, Charlene, risk, loss, uncertainty, and fear.
Okay.
How do you help a Fortune 100 CEO get their arms around risk, loss, uncertainty, fear? Charlene, what if it doesn't work? What if we throw out the baby with the bathwater? What if this future customer doesn't show up for an extra 6 months or 12 months and we've bet the company on this big risk, this big gamble, this big exciting innovation? What are those 4 words that you can kind of turn those around and say, here's how to think about those 4 words differently or more smartly?
Right. I think first of all, to get really good, to be prepared to do those really big moves, you need to start preparing today and making the small moves, because you will not have the confidence as an organization, as a leadership team, to make these big bets until you're really feeling confident that you can execute on even the smaller bets. So start now. Take little uncertain steps. Take little risks. Have little losses. And build your confidence that you can survive them. It's called resilience inside an organization and for you as a leader. But again, in the end, one of my favorite stories is Adobe, when they went from packaged software for a creative suite to Creative Cloud. And they knew doing this that they were going to lose money for 2 years. Their operating income was going to go down while they made the switch of how they recognized their revenue. More customers were coming in, but the faster they switched people over, the more money they would lose. So they went to Wall Street. I was talking to the CFO, and he goes, I've got great news. We're going to do this huge growth move, this huge pivot. It's going to be incredibly wonderful because we're going to increase our addressable market. There's this one catch. We're going to lose a lot of money. But because they were so focused on that future customer, could paint that picture, talk about the risk, the uncertainty. And they said, will you go on this journey with me? Will you go on this journey, explore this with us? And they were able to do that. And every time their money went down, their income went down, it was an indication that the strategy was succeeding. So literally, their stock price went up. I have this great chart in the book, literally the income's going down, the stock price is going up. And like, that doesn't make any sense. But it does if you understand what that future is. So I go back to when those executives at Adobe, did they have feelings about risk and loss and fear and all these things? It was coursing through them as a leadership team. And that's why you need the big gulp moment. I call it when you take hands with each other and you look at each other and like, okay, we're going to do this. Okay, ready, set, jump. And they jump. Huge risk, huge payoff though. Their stock price is up 10x over the past 8 years. So this is what you get paid for to be a leader, to create change. Your job is not to manage the status quo. Leaders create change. And if you're not creating change, taking those risks, then you're not a leader. You're a manager. And I think most people aspire to be leaders to create that change, but it is inherently risky.
Would you say, Charlene, that the more disruptive your plans, because I'm thinking of how this ties back to our leadership concept now, if you're doing the same thing the same way, it's safe, it's boring, it's vanilla, you might not hit a lot of resistance as a leader. When you're going to the very edge and you are transforming your company into being an industry disruptor, does the resistance go up among the troops? Does your leadership magnetism and your being able to cultivate followership, does that become more under the microscope more than ever if you choose to adopt a disruptive strategy?
Yes, I think that there are gradations of disruptive leadership. If you think about it, it's a scale of 1 to 10, about your capability to drive disruptive change. 1 means I don't do anything. I just like manage the status quo. 10 goes, I am really good at creating huge amounts of change and getting people to follow me in that way. And that requires a really unique set of skills. Most people fall into the middle someplace. And the reality is that you can think about great changes, but if you can't get people to follow you, you're not going to be a very effective disruptive leader. So to your point, the more change you want to create, the more you have to be able to get people to follow you, to create that idea. And frankly, you're able to create more change, the more disruptive, more into the future you look. So if your ability to look only in the next 12 months versus the next 5 years, that's going to really determine how disruptive you can be.
What a great episode. Wowza. Tell you what, if you want to ramp up your revenue as an expert who speaks professionally, you should really check out our free online training at doitmarketing.com/webinar. Are there certain kinds of disruptive patterns? Like, for example, you mentioned Adobe moving to the subscription-based, cloud-based, recurring revenue model, which Microsoft also did. Big, scary move, like, we're no longer selling boxes of software. We're going to do everything in the cloud, subscription, you know, per person, per seat, etc. So there's the subscription model. There is, you know, all kinds of other, one of the things that we'll talk about is community, and specifically your community, but another trend that we're hearing about a lot is, forget about content. Community is the new content. So don't worry about all your content marketing and, you know, preaching at people and publishing and one-way data dump. It's about the conversation. It's about the community. It's not about the content anymore. Are there other types of disruptions that you've studied, that you've written about, that maybe we should be paying attention to?
Yes. And again, I'll talk about some of them, but I'm going to do it with one big caveat. It doesn't matter. The business model that you choose is the right one for your future customer. When people focus on a particular technology or particular type of business model or particular anything, and they lose sight of who that customer is and what their needs are, you're lost. So there are a ton of different models. There's freemium, there's platforms, there's one side of platforms, there's ecosystems, there's communities, there's subscriptions. It goes on and on. Pick any of them. I don't care. Pick any of them. But be really clear why it's the right thing for that particular customer. Be really laser focused on what their needs are. And if you think it's right and you go down that research and you realize, oh, that's not right, gotta pivot. I'm in the middle of creating a community right now, and I'm doing pivots almost every single day. And it's exciting and terrifying. So I'm right in the middle of that. It's so I have a lot of empathy for other leaders who are trying to create this change. And it's pretty stomach churning. And your palms are sweating all the time. And that's when you know you're doing it right.
Yeah. Well, I love that, right? That's the data point. That's the data point that Adobe said, oh, look, we're losing money. We must be on the right path. Right. This must be working. This must be how it works.
Yes. Well, they could see the money going down, but they could see the subscribers going up. Right. So they had this new metric that they never had before. And so new business model needed new metrics, and they needed to share that with their stakeholders. And it was interesting. They needed to do this, but not in such a crazy way. They needed to hit their quarterly numbers, basically saying, we're going to lose so much next quarter, and hit that number going down, as you may think, or going up, as you may, whichever way you want to do it. But they had to hit both numbers, going up and going down, number of subscribers and the income going down.
Yeah.
They couldn't miss their numbers. And that's what drove their stock price up, to say, oh, you guys have your act together. Our confidence that you're going to execute on this strategy is there. And this is why I go back to the most disruptive organizations hit their numbers. They're incredibly well-run. They just are really good, well-run, orderly, disciplined, intentional organizations.
Talk a little bit more about this fantastic community that you're building, because you are walking the talk right here. And like you said, you're pivoting every day. The palms are sweating. What's the community? What's it about? Who's in it? And what's the purpose of the groundswell that you're creating now around disruption?
Well, in my research, I found that the disruptors are pretty lonely. It's a really lonely place out there to be a disruptor, because you're oftentimes the only person in your organization who sees this opportunity. So you're pushing against this wall constantly. So I asked them, like, how do you do this? How do you keep up the energy? How do you keep up the optimism? And they go, it's really hard. And they go, they crave being able to connect with other people who are doing this. These are sometimes people who are leading digital transformation. They're driving innovation. They're CEOs who feel like nobody else understands them. And so I wanted to create a community for disruptors where they can support and develop their disruptive leadership, that very specific place of how do I do this and do this successfully, and also receive just support from people who are like them, because it's so rare to come across another disruptor. So the community is called Quantum Networks. It's at quantum-networks.com. And we're literally just beginning it. And there's content, there's connections that you can make in discussion groups, but also in small group forums. We'll be pairing people up into about groups of 8 or 10 people who meet regularly. And then we'll also have events, both online and in the real world, where we can form connections with each other.
Very, very exciting. Yeah, how about that? Well, the book is The Disruption Mindset. And I'm going to ask you two final questions here as we're wrapping up, Charlene. The final question is, how do people get connected and stay connected to more Charlene Brilliance? And we can talk about the books, the website. We've already talked about the community, but we'll talk about the community again. Before we get there, though, the second to last question is, if folks were to take one central idea about what it takes to lead a movement, to disrupt your industry, or to create the future of the organization that you want to lead, what would you hope that central theme or concept might be?
We talked about all the future customers and things, but I think from a personal point of view, you have to live life at the end of your comfort zone, because that's where growth happens. And so if you're feeling pretty comfortable, that's great. But it's when you feel uncomfortable, when you're taking those risks every single day, that's when the magic happens. And I think that's the key thing I ask people to do. It's like, how far out of your comfort zone can you step? Because that's where you need to go as a leader to create these kinds of changes.
It's always just outside the comfort zone. Gosh darn it. You got to have the sweaty palms test.
Yes. I drink my coffee out of a mug every morning that says, life begins at the end of your comfort zone. And so I literally write down every day, like, what's the thing that I'm going to do that I'm going to step out of my comfort zone? And so I do crazy things. Like, I like to jump off of high places. I like to go rappelling. I just did my first skydive. Just to like say, okay, how does that feel like? How do I really grow and get new perspectives? That's why travel is so interesting to me. Or even just meeting random new people on the street. That's pushing me out of the comfort zone of my way of looking at the world, experiencing the world. And I ask, and I really want to support that amongst my team members, because when they're stepping out of the comfort zone, that's when we can align as a team and go off and try some crazy things. That said, I think it's really important for us to also have these times when we can center ourselves, get back to a state of consciousness as a team, look around and say, okay, is everyone here? Did we not leave anybody behind over there? Okay, we're all here. Okay, ready, set, jump again. But these cycles are what disruptive organizations do so well, but you need to go through those cycles as fast as you can.
Just a series of adventures.
Yes.
Well, how do people get connected and stay connected to more Charlene Lee? Where can we send people? We're going to hook up all these links right under this episode. As you're listening, pop over to thespeakingshow.com. Charlene, where can we send folks?
You can follow me on LinkedIn, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, all the usual suspects. LinkedIn is probably the easiest. Follow and connect with me there. But you can also go to my website, charlenelee.com. Everything's there.
Everything is there. Charlene, this was a fantastic conversation. Thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you for having me.
Well, that wraps up another episode of The Speaking Show. Hey, tell you what, if you like us, rate us and review us on iTunes. Subscribe. Tell a friend. Go grab the notes and downloads and extras at thespeakingshow.com. See you next time.